So my clock is 12:25, so at UTC time it's 10:25. So I'm happy to introduce Christoph Bogdan from Wroclaw, Poland, to give a talk on Hardy identities and Hardy inequalities.
Thank you very much for the kind introduction and for the invitation. Can you hear me?
Yes.
Okay. Especially, I thank Jana Budko Kinderknecht for being patient enough. We all have a pretty tight schedule, so I'm really happy that we can communicate in those times. Okay, so that's a new topic for me. I don't really know how to talk about it, so we'll suffer together, or maybe we'll enjoy together. Basically, I will talk about the results in the first listed paper that's on archive. All the others are the two others that I will also mention, and there will be other papers. They are published, but you can also find them on archive. And this is a result about Hardy inequalities, or I would say about potential theory of semigroups in the LP setting. Hardy inequality is an attractive topic. That's why, in a sense, we try to offer or sell this approach, starting with optimal Hardy inequalities in LP for the fractional Laplacian. My plan today is to say a few words about definitions, then I will go to results, and then, time permitting, I will try to give some insights, and that I don't know if we will have enough time to talk about it. But if you are interested, on the 30th of April, I will give a talk for an hour at the Montreal Quebec Seminar in Analysis, and then please come. Okay, and so here you can see my co-authors. This first listed paper we just finished. We are quite happy about that because it was a long project, a long time project. And let me start with definitions. So the classical Hardy inequalities started in 1920. That's over 100 years now. Hardy proved this inequality, the first one on the half line, basically. And if you want to read about the history, here's a nice book by Kufner, Maligranda, and Persson. The multidimensional classical Hardy inequality, which is in a sense for the Laplacian, but on the left-hand side, you just have the squared gradient that is the classical Dirichlet form, has this constant d minus 2 square over 4. Of course, for the dimension d equal to 2, you have a 0, so not really an interesting inequality, but that gets interesting for d equal to 3 or higher. So in a setting of symmetric Dirichlet forms, Fitzsimmons in 2000 proposed this formulation, which may be a good guiding light for us. If we have a quadratic form and a generator corresponding to this form, the generator is denoted by L, and we are in the setting of Fukushima theory of Dirichlet forms. And if we have a superharmonic function, which means it's positive and it has a negative generator on it, and then there is the Hardy inequality with the weight given by the ratio, negative LH over H. So in a sense, that's a guiding principle that we can expect in various settings, because of course there's the technology, there are some settings and frameworks to state similar results. And of course you need to guess H. Okay, since we only have 25 minutes or maybe 20 minutes now, I will go directly to my main example, which is the fractional Laplacian. And I don't really care about the operator, but for communication purposes, we need to consider it for a while. My notation is delta to the power alpha half. maybe more proper notation is the second one. And it's a principal value integral given by the Levy measure with the Levy density nu z being z to negative d minus alpha times a normalizing constant. And there is a quadratic form corresponding to this operator. And it is, the, as usual, the integral of squared increments of a function against the Levy measure. And the domain of this form is, as usual, the set of those functions in L2 that have this form finite. The classical Hardy inequality, or actually identity, is this. I mean the classical in the sense that it is known for the fractional Laplacian to hold. It's known to hold for every function in L2. And that's identity rather than inequality. In a sense, we have inequality corrected by a proper non-negative additional term. So what we have here on the left-hand side, we have the same quadratic form as on the previous slide for the fractional Laplacian. Then we have a term which is, as we should expect for the Hardy inequality. And then we have a reminder, which the easiest way to describe in words is conditional form. In a sense, all this theory has something to do with Dupe's conditioning, and we conditioned by a function h, which is just a power function with negative exponent beta. This beta will be ubiquitous here in our discussion. And beta has some range from zero to d minus alpha. Alpha needs to be smaller than d. That's only a restriction in dimension one. And then we have this additional extra term, which immediately gives you inequality. The quadratic form is bigger than the first integral times the constant. The constant is important because it's explicit and actually optimal in a sense. And it's given by some not too complicated, but also not very simple expression. And Frank Lieb and Zeiringer call it the ground state representation or identity. And they have this result that's maybe 2006 or seven. And in our paper with Dida and King, we have the full domain and slightly wider range of beta, but it doesn't matter for our discussion today. What is important about this function as a function of beta, this kappa beta, is that it is symmetric with respect to the midpoint of the interval zero d minus alpha. So this kappa beta will be our companion for the next almost 20 minutes. Here's a graph of this function on the interval zero to d minus alpha. You see a symmetry that was already announced. You see the maximum at point d minus alpha over two. Here's the value of the maximum. And that turns out to be the optimal Hardy constant for the fractional Laplacian. Recall that EU is the quadratic form of the fractional Laplacian. So this is optimal. This is known since 1970s and later on. So these are main contributors mentioned here. And so that's a presentation. It's sometimes called Hardy-Rayleigh inequality. So we want the LP setting. So it's not as simple as to change every square to P, but if you are careful enough, there's a way to proceed. So take P, a number between one and infinity, and the arbitrary measurable function U, consider this P form, which we call Sobolev-Bregman form. And this form is defined by two increments. One is the increment of a function u itself, and the other one is the increment of its power. Then we integrate against the same Levy measure. Now the power, that's the so-called French power, which is the absolute value of a number times the sign of this number. That's important. This is an increasing function if kappa is positive and p minus one is positive here. So you see that the integrand is positive. In particular, this expression is well-defined. However, it may be infinite. So we have those inequality here, which is nearly optimal in the sense that you cannot improve the left constant on the left, and the constant on the right is depending on p is between one and two. So 2 is not too bad. So there are some references about that. I will not talk about them too much, but they will be on the slides that I will make available. And of course, they're in the paper. So one consequence of such an estimate is that we can compare this P form with the quadratic form, provided that we replace every occurrence of U by U to the power P over 2, the French power. In a sense, that's what we have here. This is the integral, the integrand of this P form, and this would be the integrand of the 2 form, the usual Dirichlet form, but applied to the function U to the power P over 2. So a lot of people are content with such inequalities. Of course, this is not identity, that is equality. So in a sense, you always need to lose something. And in particular, if you use the left-hand side comparison, that you get the Hardy inequality in the LP setting. And this was stated, for instance, in the book of Cialdea and Mazia. Our goal here is to improve the constant. Okay, so for this end, we need to deal a little bit more carefully with the French powers. So again, that's the definition of the French power. For instance, x to 0 is sine of x. Square root of x is the cubic, it's the usual cubic root that we teach our students. And so that's the French power. If you differentiate this function, x to the power kappa, then you get kappa times the absolute value of x to the power kappa minus 1, at least for x different from 0. So those two functions, the absolute value of x to the power and x to the French power, they come together. One is the derivative of the other, basically. So let's consider this expression, fp, that's the main hero of the presentation, a simple modest function, which we called Bregman divergence. What we have here is basically the second order Taylor expansion of the function absolute value of a to the power p. That's about the increment between a and b. That is actually the second order Taylor expansion. For p equal to 2, you get the usual squared difference. For other values of p, the formula is not so simple. It's probably better to keep it as a notation fp. Okay, Bregman divergence is now used quite widely in statistics, but I need to just go on. So there are some estimates of this fp. First of all, because x to the power p is a convex function, we have fp, this Taylor reminder, non-negative. That's a result, a consequence of convexity. Secondly, you can have explicit estimate. Remember that we are in the regime between p and p equal to 1 and infinity. The 1 and infinity are excluded. And this comparison means that the ratio of those two expressions is bounded between two constants, positive constants, in all range, in all the domain. So that's one approximation. That's the other one that was mentioned before. And the authors in this field more often use the second one. It's quite strange that we have two equivalent comparisons, and one may be more useful than the other depending on the context. Here's the comparison with the usual powers of the increments, which really don't compare with fp. That is, they compare one side depending on p. And that's really not what we are talking about here. So this function fp is not symmetric, but if you consider symmetrization, then we get this expression. That's nice algebra. You could check it yourself and things simplify. And that's really the integrand of the form, the p form ep. And we want to keep it this way. So once again, we have comparison of the p form with the quadratic form applied to u to the power p over 2, the French power. But this comparison is not having optimal constants, not leading to optimal constants. So we can use it in estimates, but not really in the optimal results. So here are our results. I need this function h to condition, in a sense to condition. I'm not explaining what it means conditioning. Basically, it means multiplying by a function, another function by a fixed factor, h. This will be h to the power negative b as before. We are on Rd. And here's the result. Let me spell all the details. Alpha is between 0 and 2 as usual and less than d. That's in a sense for transients. Beta has some restricted range compared with the case of p equal to 2. If p equals to 2, this factor is 1. If p is different than 2, then the factor is smaller than 1. So we have a certain restriction. And then we have this hard identity, actually, not inequality, but identity. The first term is what we would expect, what we wait for, the estimate of u to the power p over x to the power alpha. And there is some constant, which we will discuss in a moment. And there is additional term, which has a pretty complicated structure, and this has this function fp, which is non-negative. So that's nice to have a non-negative term. And let's focus on the first term for now. If we take beta equal to d minus alpha over p, then by inspection of the two terms, those two kappas here, they turn out to be equal. And the constant simplifies, and we get this kappa on the left. And this is true. Our technique of proving such a result usually gives the full domain, that is the full LP. It turns out that this constant is optimal, which is the topic of the next slide. Again, this inequality that we obtain by choosing a particular beta. If p is different than 2, this constant is better than the constant that we had in the inequality that, for instance, Mazia and Chaldea have in their book. Here is a stronger result even than this inequality, namely that the constant here is sharp, meaning that you cannot make it bigger and still have the inequality for every u in LP. So that's a second main theorem of our first paper. And let me give some consequences, because in a sense, we are investing here time, as some other people did, in the behavior, in the theory of generators of Markovian semigroups and maybe of those semigroups on LP. And we would like to see an outcome. And here's the application, actually two applications. We consider the Feynman-Katz semigroup generated by this Schrödinger type operator. Recall that delta to the power alpha half is a negative operator, the generator of the, that's the fractional Laplacian, it's negative. And then we add a positive term, which may create explosion. That's a quite singular perturbation. Kappa is a positive number, and I will say about this kappa in a moment. And there is this x to the power negative alpha. This is, as usual, a function that you multiply a function u if you want to apply the operator to the function. So here's a first result. In this regime that we talk about, the operator p tilde t, that's actually a semigroup, is a contraction on LP if and only if kappa is less than this critical kappa for this p, kappa d minus alpha over p. This is sharp, I mean, this is if and only if. And I should mention the similar result for the Laplacian, for the classical Laplacian. The result says that the critical constant is kappa of d minus 2 over p, defined by the same formula. Actually, it's simpler in a sense, a limiting result that agrees with our formula if we take, in a sense, alpha equal to 2. So there are authors that have this, papers by Semyonov and co-authors and Arendt and co-authors. And this theorem 3 is a direct consequence of our results. And there is a theorem 4. which is a consequence of other results that we obtained in before in 2019. And this result, this theorem says that the operator P tilde T is bounded on LP if and only if kappa is less than kappa of D over P star, where P star is the greater of P and the conjugate exponent. This is a less restrictive condition because of monotonicity of kappa. Okay, so here are the results, and I should give you some insights. So I need to choose because we have only 5 minutes. Our methods are really methods of semigroup theory and really about integral kernels of symmetric Markovian semigroup of sub-Markovian, actually also super-Markovian, but non-negative kernels. And so in this setting that we talked about, the role is played by the Levy measure density that was already presented. There is this symbol, really the symbol up to a sign of the fractional Laplacian. And there is this semigroup PT, which has this Fourier transform. That's really a Levy-Kinchin formula. That's a convolution semigroup of measures, which is really well known. And the corresponding semigroup of operators given by this integration is extremely well known. Let's call it the semigroup generated by the fractional Laplacian. Of course, it depends on the context, but we basically talk here about the kernel, which is a nice smooth function. This function has nice properties, of which I will only mention one, maybe two. One thing is that if you let t to zero, then ptxy converges to nu of x minus y, at least when x is different from y. But that's quite typical. What is less typical and actually facilitates our calculations, which are otherwise quite general, is this majorization of the ratio by the Levy measure. I will just stop at this and will give a consequence for the fractional Laplacian. One consequence is the following. If we consider the P form, the Sobolev-Bregman form of the fractional Laplacian, it can be defined, that is, it is equal to this limit where ET is the usual approximation that's usual in the theory of Dirichlet forms. But here we allow U in LP and V in the conjugate space. And here, what that really means is that EP is this pairing of the generator applied to U times u to the power p minus one. And I cannot spend much time about talking about generalizations. So let's just be content with this fractional Laplacian here. Now, what is our technology? Our technology is to construct directly a superharmonic function h. And this is done. Let's forget about the subordination, which is, by the way, a method to do explicit calculations. So, here's a way to construct an explicitly a superharmonic function in the setting of symmetric, in the setting of semigroups, Markovian of sub-Markovian semigroups. You integrate this semigroup against increasing function of t, and let this be. Then it is kind of easy or obvious in a sense that it is supermedian or superharmonic, if you like. And then we consider this ratio, 1 over h, times a similar expression where you replace f by the derivative of this function f. Here the function is a power function with a positive exponent. And then by explicit calculations, I mentioned that it's possible to do them by subordination. We get that not only we have this inequality, but we have a similar inequality, which I call the non-explosion result for the corresponding Schrödinger semigroup. So that's one, and I need to choose another. How we insight to theorem two would be the following. If this is a function which really reverses the Hardy inequality, the optimal Hardy inequality, if beta is such that kappa beta is bigger than this critical beta. That depends on P. Unfortunately, that's quite technical. I cannot do anything better, I think, at this time. And maybe the last thing, if you consider the Schrödinger, the Feynman-Katz perturbation, the semi-group and solution to the abstract Cauchy problem, and if we observe the evolution of the integral of the p power of the solution, then we arrive at the form, at the p form, which in a sense shows that this is the right object to consider, and under our hard inequality, we have this being negative, that means contractivity. And maybe last more thing, inside on theorem four, in this third mentioned paper, we have estimates of the heat kernel of the Schrödinger operator. And since they are explicit and sharp, that is two-sided, then we can easily prove the boundedness of p tilde for beta less than this exponent, this number, and not for other betas. I think I should stop at this because, unfortunately, my time is over. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much for this very interesting talk. Are there any questions, comments?
Can I ask a question?
Sure.
Okay. I would like to see this theorem connected with semigroups, maybe theorem two or three. I don't remember the number. Well, you have that the semigroup is a contraction, yes?
Mm-hmm.
Okay. You have in both terms, in Laplacian and in the source term, you have some alpha. If you replace one of these alpha by some beta, for example, so then the behavior of this semigroup does not depend on kappa, I understand?
It does depend on kappa. It does depend also on the exponent in the potential x to the power negative something. Somehow this alpha is the same, must be the same for the operator and for the potential. Of course, it could alpha could be smaller. Then we are in the setting of perturbation theory of semigroups. They are not critical perturbation. Here in the setting of critical perturbation, if you exceed the value of kappa, which is the critical one for p equal to 2, which is kappa of kappa with the index d minus alpha over 2, then you have explosion. The semigroup is infinite. This is a counterpart of the famous result of Goldstein and Barras and Goldstein. Okay. In a sense, if the exponent in the potential kernel is more singular than in the operator, then you have immediate explosion. That's one consequence in a sense.
So you simply choose some critical situation when you change one alpha to beta, then everything is much simpler, yeah?
So yes, that's right. And we have results on such situations in the setting of Kato condition on the potential. Yeah. Or you have explosion if you overdo.
Okay, are there any further questions or comments?
Yes, I would like to ask a question.
Hi.
Well, your talk illustrates the fact that an insight of a probabilist may influence the theory of semigroups of operators by providing nice generation theorems. But knowing you, it is hard to believe for me that that there are no probabilistic consequences of your theorems. What does it mean? What do these generation theorems mean for the Levy processes that are hidden behind this?
I can only speculate.
Okay, so this was not. I thought this. You had some kind of background before you wanted, before proving these theorems?
Let me see. Somehow my slides disappeared once again. Let me stop sharing and let me just maybe comment in words. This part is purely analytic. Of course, we use as an input data the semi-group of a special Levy process, but then this is really about construction and consequences of existence of superharmonic functions. And we try to state it in this setting of semi-groups, quite manageable Markovian semi-groups. We feel comfortable in this setting. And in a sense, that's about potentials. As I mentioned, this construction of a function H, which is used in the so-called Dubbs conditioning, is a crucial thing. I don't quite understand why it works, but somehow it is an extension of what you usually do with the potential kernel with the Green function. And that's what you do with those H. So I could speculate at what it means for the stochastic process. Probably what happens is that most trajectories don't visit zero. If they visit zero, but there is some of them that visit the neighborhood of zero, and they contribute a lot to this mass, and the semigroup explodes if kappa is too large. I'm not sure if this is convincing or interesting. So maybe we should look. Oh, there is another thing of interest for us to try to understand the limiting behavior at zero, and maybe that will be another conditioning and more probabilistic interpretation. And maybe that's very loose comment. As we condition the semigroup, the Schrödinger semigroup, because in a sense it's in the background all the time here. If we condition, then we have a Markovian or sub-Markovian semigroup. It depends on this H. And then this would be some kind of maybe Ornstein-Lambeck process with repulsion, but probably non-local. We are trying to learn this. We are still learning this. That's a strange forest for us.
Okay, thank you.
Okay, thank you. Are there further questions, comments?
I have one, if I can.
Yeah. Sure.
So, Christoph. Two questions, let me say. The first one is the following. In the classical Hardy inequality, I mean just the classical for the Laplacian, the inequality is basically one dimensional, I would say, because even the n-dimensional proof uses only the radial derivative, let me say. So I wonder if this is the same in your for the alpha Laplacian, because the proof was genuinely n-dimensional, what you gave before. And the second question connects with the semigroup that you called, I think, P tilde. So you have a range where the semigroup is contractive and a larger range where the semigroup still exists and is non-contractive. And then I'm quite used to this situation. So I'm just asking, but how you prove the existence of a non-contractive semigroup in this larger for many other p's where the semigroup is no longer contractive.
Okay, as far as the first question, we are lucky that our functions, that the kernel of the semigroup is unimodal, that is radially decreasing. And in a sense, the calculations are, they produce functions which are functions of the radius only. Distance. So in a sense, that's one dimensional. On the other hand, we use calculations with the Brownian motion, which with the Weierstrass kernel, the Gauss-Weierstrass kernel, which somehow simplifies it, maybe also hides from us some details. So we are lucky that there is a formalism that we could use. So in a sense, it depends on calculations of integrals where you have Gauss-Weierstrass kernel times a power function. Okay. So that's maybe some kind of answer. Of course, there are many proofs of the classical hard inequality, and some of them maybe emphasize the PDE's part of maybe one-dimensional situation. Some of them may emphasize the potential theoretic background, because to me, hard inequality is a result of conditioning. That is, considering for a function u and the superharmonic function h, considering the quadratic form applied to u times h. That seems to lend to generalize to other settings. Okay, and the second part was you started with the description of how the semigroup behaves. I realized that somehow one should say that the case of p equal to 2 is in a sense the simplest, and p different than 2 is harder. P equal to 2, there is always a contractivity or explosion.
Yeah.
For p different than 2, and there is, as you said, contractivity. In a wider range, there's boundedness. In a wider range, there's unboundedness, but the kernel does not explode, and only it does not act on LP. And then there is explosion that is, we leave all the LPs and L2 and everything. Now, if I remember, did you ask about the kernel of this Schrödinger Feynman cuts?
No, just if I understand you, check when the kernel acts on LP, even though it's not contractive. The same group is not contractive. It's a kind of this argument that you...
Yes. So this this argument that we have a bounded operator on LP, first of all, this is non-negative kernel, which we define by in terms of perturbation series. So that's straightforward, only that we need to rule out the explosion.
Mm-hmm.
And in a sense, this first paper with Dida and Kim already gives that. The kernel does not explode. But then to have a control on what's going on LP, we are lucky because in the second mentioned paper, we have sharp estimates of the heat kernel. And as in your talk yesterday, with such estimates, I struggled a little bit because I'm a little bit unused to such estimates, but then you have bounds on LP.
Hmm.
Yeah. Also the lower bounds, in the sense you can show that if there is a function that the semigroup takes you out of this LP immediately or by approximation.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. So we are basically using, that's a free ride on our previous paper.
Okay.
Okay, thank you. Are there any further short questions or comments? Okay, this does not seem to be the case. Then let's Christoph again, and let's thank all the speakers of our session.
Thank you.
And now it's lunch break.